بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Our lecture will be on regulation of respiration presented by Dr. Shireen Samir. So first, we must know that respiration has both voluntary and involuntary regulation. Right, the involuntary regulation or involuntary respiration is generated by the activity of respiratory centers and also mainly regulation of respiration involuntary. Yani we have voluntary and involuntary, but the involuntary override the voluntary regulation of respiration. Involuntary done by respiratory centers. These respiratory centers are collection of neurons. Collection of neurons. That located in brain stem. We have in brain stem either medullary or pontine centers. So we will discuss the respiratory centers. These respiratory centers presented in brain stem. These brain stem either in bones or medullary centers. We have medullary centers dorsal respiratory, which behind the ventral one. So we have in front the ventral respiratory group and behind the dorsal respiratory group. Also the pontine centers, we will have the amniotic lower down, and above in the upper third of bones, we will have the pneumotaxic center. So again, we will have medullary respiratory centers. These medullary respiratory centers are either ventral respiratory or dorsal respiratory. We will have the ventral respiratory group. We must know that it is inspiratory neurons and expiratory neurons. But the dorsal respiratory group contain only inspiratory neurons. So first, what will be the dorsal respiratory group? This dorsal respiratory group, or what we call it inspiratory neurons, we will have, it is mainly inspiratory neurons, have the property of intrinsic periodic firing. What we mean about this, it has the inherent property to induce action potential and send impulse. So it firing means it induce action potential. So it has this property to induce without stimulation from another side. So discharge during inspiration only will activate the lower neurons in the spinal cord, supplying the diaphragm and the external intercostal muscle. It will be inactive during expiration. So again, when we talk about the dorsal respiratory group, it contains only inspiratory neurons. So it is active during inspiration and inactive during expiration. Inactive during expiration. It discharges inherently. It discharges without any stimuli. So it has intrinsic property for periodic firing or periodic discharging. Means that it discharges in tides. So this discharge or sending action potential will activate the lower respiratory neuron supplying the lower neurons in the spinal cord that supply external intercostal and. So the action of dorsal respiratory group, what we call it inspiratory ramp signal. So this is the basic rhythm of respiration generated mainly for dorsal respiratory group. يبقى الانسبيراتوري ريزم جنريتور او الانسبيراتوري بيس ميكر او الريسبيراتوري بيس ميكر ويل بي يبقى ده البيس ميكر ويل بي هو الدورز الريسبيراتوري جروب. يبقى when I asked you about the inspiratory بيس ميكر او inspiratory جنريتور او الرامب سيجنال done by a by الدورز الريسبيراتوري جروب. These dorsal respiratory groups set a normal rhythm for respiration in a ramp signal. What we mean about a ramp signal? Ramp signal means to start to initiate a respiration أو الـ inspiration in weak bursts of action, weak action potential, then it will gradually increases in amplitude, then it will cease again till another cycle will be presented. يبقى again it's in the weak impulses في الـ first. Weak action potentials, then it gradually increases the action potential during inspiration, then ceases again, stop discharging during expiration, then start discharging again for next inspiration or next respiratory cycle. So when we talk about the ventral, what about the ventral respiratory group? We have medullary respiratory groups or medullary respiratory centers contain dorsal which active only during inspiration, and we call it the inspiratory ramp signal or inspiratory rhythm generator or inspiratory pacemaker. What about the ventral respiratory group? The ventral respiratory group contain both expiratory and inspiratory neurons. It is located anterolateral to the dorsal respiratory group. يبقى behind the dorsal respiratory, anterior ventral respiratory. Totally inactive during the normal quiet breathing. يبقى it has no role during the normal quiet breathing. Some ventral respiratory group inspiratory and the other expiratory. The inspiratory activated only during the forced breathing or forced inspiration. To augment the inspiratory REM signals in the dorsal respiratory group, most of the ventral expiratory discharge stimulate also muscles of forced expiration like the internal, intercostal, and abdominal. So, in normal quiet breathing, the ventral respiratory are inactive. The ventral respiratory group inactive during the normal quiet breathing. It is active only in a enforced, either forced inspiration or forced expiration, it will act. So this chart shows that a dorsal respiratory group will active the only new center اللي active during the normal quiet breathing. The only active during the quiet breathing will send the inspiration or inspiratory signals to the diaphragm and the external intercostal muscle. The ventral respiratory group will be active only during the forced inspiration or the forced expiration. What about the pontine centers? The pontine centers will contain pneumotaxic center and amniotic center. What is the role of this pontine? The role of this pontine center is to modify or regulate the rate and the depth of respiration. Not initiate respiration. يبقى ال initiate respiration دي المدلري centers mainly the dorsal respiratory group. The dorsal respiratory group دي initiate ال respiration. But regulation للrate والdepth done بالpontine center. الابنيوستيك دي switch on and the pneumotaxic switch off. فالابنيوستيك here في lower part will send stimulatory signals to the dorsal respiratory group to switch on respiration, and the pneumotaxic will send it to the amniotic and will send it to the dorsal to switch off this respiration. So when we talk about the amniotic center, it is located in the lower third. So the amniotic, it is in lower third near the medullary group. Send the continuous excitatory impulse to the dorsal respiratory group, thus facilitating inspiration. So, the dorsal respiratory has inherent ability to produce action potential within the signals to the spinal cord neurons. But it receives all the time excitatory impulse coming from the amniotic center. So, to switch on inspiration or to facilitate inspiration, what can switch off inspiration? What can inhibit this dorsal respiratory group? Will be a pneumotaxic center. So pneumotaxic center in upper bones, in area what we call it a nucleus parabrachialis, this will control a cessation of inspiratory ramp signals from neurons in dorsal respiratory. If this pneumotaxic center will send inhibitory impulse to what? To the amniotic and to a dorsal respiratory group to switch off inspiration, to say that's enough for inspiration and all medullary centers will be inactive, so expiration will occur passively. So this will switch off dorsal respiratory and also the amniotic, so expiration will occur. Its major role is regulation of respiratory volume and rate. So if a pneumotaxis center will discharge rapidly, so it will switch off inspiration more rapidly, so increasing rate and decreasing depth of respiration. But if a pneumotaxis center sent a slow rate of impulse, so inspiration will take more time and a respiratory cycle more time, so respiratory rate will be less or slow with more dips in respiration. So generation of rhythmic respiration, what will occur in the mechanism of respiration? In inspiration, the dorsal respiratory group will fire by itself and also under continuous stimulatory discharge from the amniotic. So a dorsal respiratory will discharge by itself and also under continuous stimulation from the amniotic center to go to the lower or send signal to the lower motor neurons that supply external intercostal and the diaphragm to expand the lung. This nerves that supply diaphragm and external intercostal, you will have this in anatomy, and it signals sent to these neurons in the spinal cord to say or discharge, to say contract and to expand the lung. Then inhibitory impulse coming from a pneumotaxis center, this will suppress the dorsal respiratory group and terminate the inspiration, so relaxation the inspiratory muscle will expiration. Okay, again briefly, dorsal respiratory will send ramp signals from the medulla and also due to stimulation from the amniotic to the lower neurons supply diaphragm and external intercostal causing inspiration. After that, a pneumotaxis will send inhibitory impulse. This inhibitory suppress a dorsal respiratory group and the expiration occur. What can regulate this respiratory center? What made a respiratory center to be active, to be suppressed? What can stimulate a pneumotaxis to inhibit more rapidly or to act slowly? What to make an amniotic or a dorsal respiratory group to initiate impulse more rapidly? So regulation of these respiratory centers could be done by nervous signals or nervous regulation or chemical regulation. The nervous regulation, either impulse from a higher center or reflexes from other body system. The chemical, either by peripheral chemoreceptors or central chemoreceptors. You have chemical by chemoreceptors, peripheral or central, and nervous, either from higher centers or from the body. What about the higher centers? First, we will have nervous from the higher center. Higher centers, either cerebral cortex or hypothalamus. So we will have hypothalamus limbic system. So a cerebral first to cerebral cortex. When I say cerebral cortex, so we will speak about the conscious perception or a consciousness. So by voluntary control or regulate of respiration. A CNS has limited ability to override the automatic regulation of respiration for short time. It has the ability to override the automatic or involuntary regulation, yes, but limited ability. It will be for short time. If I can ask you to hold your breath voluntarily, so you can hold your breath voluntarily, but for very, very short time, then the automatic respiration will occur, will override. Why? Because when you hold, if you hold your breath or cause voluntary apnea and cessation of respiration or stoppage of respiration, this will accumulate the CO2 in your blood, increase the CO2, will stimulate the respiratory center to act. Also, if I asked you to hyperventilate or to respirate rapidly, so you can do this for while, very few minutes, but the automatic regulation also can overcome respiration. Why? Because if you hyperventilate or increase the respiratory rate, this will lead to get rid of more CO2 than normal, so CO2 will decrease. This will inhibit the respiratory center against your will. So this is a regulation or an impulse coming from cerebral cortex. What about the impulse from another higher center other than the cerebral cortex, what we call it the hypothalamus or limbic system? The hypothalamus or limbic system can affect the respiratory activity in certain conditions. These are the areas that perceive the sensation, the pain, the emotion, so temperature also. So in pain and the emotion, if we suffer from mild to moderate pain, it will associated with sympathetic stimulation, and the sympathetic, as you know, it will increase the respiratory rate. But a severe one will stimulate the parasympathetic stimulation, which lead to decrease or slow breathing. The same in temperature. If we exposed the higher temperature, like in fever in our body, the temperature in our body will be increased. So this will accelerate the respiration to get rid of more heat in form of water vapor. The evaporation of water coming out in the body in the respiratory tract. Also, if you suffer from low temperature, or low external temperature, like exposing the cold or exposing the cold shower, so you will suffer from apnea followed by deep inspiration. This apnea followed by deep inspiration, this is due to stimulation of the hypothalamus and limbic system, which affect the respiratory center. So we have nervous regulation or control done by higher center, cerebral cortex, limbic system, or hypothalamus. Also, we will have nervous control by what we call it reflexes from other body system. Reflexes from the body, either from a respiratory system or from other body system. A respiratory system, either upper airway or lower airway lung. The other body system, coming from the cardiovascular, coming from the skeletal muscle, coming from the viscera. First, we will have reflexes coming from a respiratory system. We will have reflexes from an upper airway or from a lower airway or lung. An upper airway, it can come from a nose, like sneezing, or coming from a trachea, like a cough, or coming from a pharynx, like a deglutition or a swallowing reflex. We have sneezing reflex, cough reflex, deglutition or swallowing reflex. Also, we will have reflexes coming from lower respiratory airway and the lung, such as reflexes coming from stimulation of irritant receptors, stretch receptors, what we call it C receptors or G receptors. So we will have reflexes or nervous reflexes from upper airway, like coming from a nose, like a sneezing reflex. What we need to know about this, if any stimulus, irritant stimulus like dust, like foreign body, like smoking, like any irritant odor, so this can stimulate the irritant receptors inside the nose or nasal mucosa. It will send impulses or action potential through a trigeminal nerve going to the respiratory center to cause deep inspiration and followed by forced expiration, expelling out any foreign. If you imagine the sneezing reflex, it will be deep inspiration followed by deep expiration to expel a foreign particle from your nose. What about the swallowing reflex or deglutition reflex or deglutition apnea? The stimulus here will be a food. bolus or amount of food that coming in the upper pharynx or oropharynx. This will stimulate the swallowing receptors in oropharynx, and the impulse sent through the glossopharyngeal. This is number 9, so this is glossopharyngeal nerve, going to the respiratory center to cause inhibition of this respiratory center, inhibition of respiration, to close the nasopharynx by soft palate and close the larynx by glottis, close the airways, and lift the esophagus only open to pass the food bolus through it, so prevent the aspiration of food for respiratory passage. So we have the cough reflex. Also, the cough reflex, it has the same stimulus like sneezing, and more than this. It can be irritant also. This irritant, either mechanical like foreign body, dust, anything, or chemical like what we call it, histamine or prostaglandin. It may be chemical released during allergy, during hypersensitivity. This allergy associated release many chemical substances, اللي هي الهستامين والسيروتونين والسلو رياكتنج سبستانس of anaphylaxis. These substances will be released in a blood vessel, will affect the wall أو الميوكوزا of the trachea. This stimulate the irritant receptors في the upper airway, send the impulses through the vagus, and will cause deep inspiration followed by forced expiration against the closed glottis. So this can initiate high pressure inside the bronchi or trachea. When the glottis open, it will expel or eject the foreign body forcefully. Again, I can ask you about the nervous regulation as a whole. Nervous regulation as a whole, you must tell me nervous regulation من the higher center or nervous regulation من from the other parts of the body. The nervous regulation in the body must be from respiratory or from a other parts, cardiovascular skeletal vessel. The respiratory, either upper airway reflexes, or upper airway reflexes, sneezing reflex from irritant, deep inspiration followed by deep expiration, with the carried petrogen. The swallowing or deglutition, it will be stimulated by food, carried by the glossopharyngeal, and it cause closure li inhibition of respiration, closure li nasopharynx wal glottis, and opening li esophagus. Type the cough, deep irritant, chemical or mechanical, will send it through the vagus, cause deep inspiration followed by forced expiration against a closed glottis. From the lower respiratory airway or lung, it will be either from C or G receptors. These receptors present, or we call it the pulmonary C receptor or G receptors. This G coming from juxtacapillary. Juxtacapillary means beside. So it will be around the pulmonary capillary. Around the pulmonary capillary will sense the congestion in these capillaries. Will sense a pulmonary congestion or a pulmonary edema or any chemical substances through this capillary. يبقى أي chemical substance like الهستامين, البروستاجلاندين, البراديكينين, السيروتونين, these chemicals in pulmonary capillary or congestion or edema في pulmonary, so this could be sensed by these C receptors or G receptors, will cause a apnea followed by shallow rapid respiration, and this occur in pulmonary edema, apnea and shallow respiration. Shallow respiration, what we call it, dyspnea, shortness of breath. What about the irritant receptor? The irritant receptors could initiate many reflexes. One of these is the cough reflex or sneezing reflex. So we will, when we have irritant substance or stimuli, either chemical or mechanical, it can initiate sneezing when passing in the nose, or cough reflex in the trachea, or when passed in the lower airway with lung. It can stimulate the irritant receptors, and cause several reflexes like a cough, a bronchoconstriction, and mucus hypersecretion. When irritation reach a lung or lower airway, it increases mucus secretion with bronchoconstriction and initiate cough reflex. Last reflex, we will have what we call it the stretch reflex or herring blower reflexes. It is very, very, very important. I can ask you many questions about the herring blower. The herring blower reflex or the stretch reflex, the stimulus will be either over distension in the lung or under a tightness in the lung. So here we will have a herring blower inflation, or what we call it an over distension in the lung. This over distension in the lung will stimulate the stretch receptors inside the trachea, the bronchiole, the alveoli. This will send vagal afferents or vagal signals. This through vagus, vagal signals, through the vagus to inhibit the inspiration and to protect the lung from over inflation. So it will not occur in normal quiet breathing. In normal quiet breathing, we will have a pneumotaxis to send the inhibitory impulse to the amniotic and dorsal. But here, in forced inspiration, when the lung is stretched and the lung will contain tidal volume around the 1 to 1.5 liter, normally we will have 500 milli only, yani half liter. If it exceeds to 1 to 1.5 liter, so it is forced inspiration, it is maximum stretch to protect the lung from rupture. So it will send the vagus to inhibit the amniotic with dorsal respiratory group. So in stretch receptors, as I told you, the stretch receptors will be responsible for herring blower reflexes. Well, herring blower reflex, either we have inflation reflex or deflation reflex. In inflation reflex, feel inspiration, feel inflation, herring blower inflation. When we have inspiration or inflation in the lung, it will stimulate the stretch receptors of the bronchiole, send the vagus to inhibit the dorsal respiratory group with amniotic. It will inhibit the dorsal with amniotic other than a pneumotaxis. This will inhibit by the vagus to protect or prevent the excess inflation, stop inspiration and start the expiration. What about the herring blower deflation? To the contrary, when we have excessive deflation of a lung to protect against the collapse, it will stimulate the stretch receptors or deflation receptors. This will send also vagus to inhibit the expiration, inhibit impulse expiratory center and start the inspiration. So for the excessive deflation, this is what about the expiratory center, yani the ventral respiratory group. Here the ventral respiratory group is stimulated for forced expiration and cause forced expiration. So this forced expiration deflation in the lung will send the impulse to through vagus also to inhibit this ventral respiratory group and start the inspiration again. يبقى ده protective, the herring blower protective against the excessive inflation or excessive. What about the reflexes from the other parts of the body? We'll have reflexes first from the cardiovascular system. From cardiovascular, we have from the right side or the left side of the heart. The right side, we call it Harrison reflex. The left side, we call it baroreceptor reflex. What about the Harrison reflex? From the right side. The right side of heart responsible for what we call it the venous return. The blood returned to the heart, venous return. So increasing in venous return will stimulate the stretch receptor in right atrium and send also through vagus to increase the respiratory center to increase the respiratory rate. This will help more oxygenation while the blood coming oxygenation in excess venous return. Again, the Harrison reflex means relation between venous return and respiratory rate. If the venous return increase, the respiratory rate increase. What is the aim? Is to oxygenate to remove CO2 from this excess venous return. The venous return increase in right atrium. So it will stimulate the stretch receptors. These stretch receptors will send the vagus to stimulate the respiratory rate to oxygenate this excess. طب what about the baroreceptor? This is from the left side. This is relationship also. يبقى التانية ال first كانت relationship between the venous return and respiratory rate. ودي direct relationship. What about this baroreceptor? This inversely relationship or inverse proportion between the arterial blood pressure with respiratory rate. When the arterial blood pressure is increased, it will stimulate the baroreceptor. والباروريسبتورز دي بريزنت فين؟ بريزنت اراوند المين بلاد فيسلز اراوند الاورتا والكاروتيد ساينس. This baroreceptor sense the arterial blood pressure. When the arterial blood pressure increases, it will send the impulse through the vagus also will glossopharyngeal respiratory center to inhibit this respiratory rate. Inhibition of the respiratory rate will decrease the venous return. Why? Because I told you that the respiratory rate will increase, we increase the negativity of the thorax, it will suck more blood in venous return. So inhibition of the respiratory rate will movement of the skeletal the respiratory muscle. We will decrease the negativity of thorax will decrease the venous return. So decrease the cardiac output, the blood coming from the aorta, so decrease the arterial blood pressure. يبقى increase the arterial blood pressure will stimulate the baroreceptors to decrease the respiratory rate will cardiac output and correct the arterial blood pressure again. As evidence of this, our example, what we call it adrenaline apnea. If we inject the adrenaline intravenous, large dose من الادرينالين will cause vasoconstriction للblood vessel. This will increase the blood pressure. When the blood pressure increased, we will find that the respiratory rate will be decreased to finally decrease the arterial blood pressure. Now, what occurs in decrease the arterial blood pressure? Decrease the arterial blood pressure will decrease the rate of inhibitory impulse. يعني the arterial blood pressure will increase the rate of inhibitory impulse. Increase the rate of inhibitory impulse. اللي coming من الباروريسبتور للرespiratory center. When decrease the arterial blood pressure, it will decrease the rate of inhibitory impulse. Decrease the rate of inhibitory impulse. من the baroreceptor, so respiratory rate will be increased. يبقى دي inverse relation between the arterial blood pressure and respiratory rate. Also, question may become as mentioned the reflex coming from the left side of the heart. أو regulation of the cardio coming from the cardiovascular on the respiratory rate to say left or right, the Harrison will baroreceptor. From the skeletal muscle, the skeletal muscle contraction أو movement will stimulate the receptors في muscle اللي هي proprio receptors اللي present في muscle with tendon and joints, and these receptors will send somatic nerves to regulate or increase the respiratory rate from the respiratory center to supply more oxygen. يبقى we have also a movement our in exercise during exercise or doing any work. Skeletal muscle will send the impulse from its receptors through somatic nerves to regulate the respiration to increase it. Also we have afferent impulse or reflexes from the viscera if we suffer from abdominal pain or abdominal pain also may mild to moderate to increase the respiratory rate through sympathetic or severe to decrease the respiratory rate by parasympathetic. Also in vomiting or hiccough or yawning, these reflexes coming from GIT can affect the respiration. Lastly, we will speak about the chemical regulation of respiration. What about the chemical regulation of the respiratory center activity? How can we it is regulated? It is regulated through what we call it chemoreceptors. Chemoreceptors, we have both peripheral and central chemoreceptors. Regarding the peripheral chemoreceptors, it is present in what we call it the aortic body or the carotid or the carotid body. The carotid body, this is aortic bodies. The aortic bodies are the arch of the aorta and they send the impulse through the vagus. يبقى the aortic body sends through the vagus. What about the carotid body? The carotid body and the bifurcation of the carotid. يبقى this is what we call it the carotid bodies and send the impulses through the glossopharyngeal. This will send to the middle. يبقى the aortic body sends through the vagus. Through vagus للمضلة والكاروتيد send through يبقى this is the vagus this is the vagus ف send through the vagus والكاروتيد send through glossopharyngeal to medullary centers. What about these peripheral chemoreceptors? The carotid body here again the aortic body send through the vagus والكاروتيد body send through glossopharyngeal. The carotid body here has very high blood flow around 2000 milli every minute, 100 gram tissue per minute. Every minute, each gram of the tissue will contain each gram of the tissue will supply by 20 milli of blood. This is very, very high blood flow. So it will be affected by the level of oxygen. So the oxygen needed for these cells can be satisfied by physical dissolved oxygen alone, so it is sensitive to minor change in PO2. What we mean about this? The oxygen will be carried in blood either on hemoglobin, what we call it chemical combination, or it is some amount, some minor amounts of oxygen will be dissolved in plasma, so we call it physical dissolved. يبقى الphysical dissolved ديت some very small amount of oxygen dissolved in plasma without binding to الhemoglobin. So the high amount of blood supply to the carotid make these carotid bodies supplied satisfied only by this small amount of physical dissolved oxygen without a need to have oxygen from الhemoglobin. So it will be affected to any minor changes in A in PO2. يبقى ال PO2 ده ال oxygen tension اللي determined by the physical dissolved. يبقى ال physical dissolved can appear as PO2. يبقى ال PO2 this is according to the saturation of أو ال amount of the oxygen اللي physically dissolved. So these carotid bodies very sensitive for any fall in PO2. This any fall in PO2, also any increase in CO2 or in hydrogen concentration. But it is very, very sensitive or maximally stimulated when the arterial PO2, BaO2, this is arterial PO2 or arterial oxygen tension, decrease below 60 millimeter mercury. So when we see this chart, it means in the arterial PO2, when it is increased here, so the amount of response for peripheral chemoreceptors is very, very small. When it is decreased below 60, so it is it will elevated or respond maximally for this low PO2. This, they detected changes in dissolved oxygen, but not in oxygen bound hemoglobin. So in A, يبقى not bound للهيموغلوبين. يبقى في الأنيميا. الأنيميا. هيبقى الكيموريسيبتورز دي أو البريفرال كيموريسيبتورز stimulated or not. لا. It has no relation with anemia. لأن الأنيميا decrease في الهيموغلوبين. It has no effect على الphysical dissolved oxygen. So الphysical dissolved oxygen only. الA which affect ال peripheral chemoreceptors or carotid bodies. Besides CO2 will hydrogen certainly, but most affected be how, this is for your knowledge, how hypoxia or decreased oxygen can stimulate or fire the peripheral chemoreceptors. Here we have a blood supply and this is a carotid body and this is the nerve اللي هو الglossopharyngeal. When the oxygen tension أو the oxygen dissolved in blood here will be decreased, so this oxygen أو decrease the oxygen can close the potassium channels in carotid bodies. So this closure of the potassium channel will cause the cell to be depolarized. cause the potassium, cause repolarization. So closure the potassium, make the cell in depolarization. So it will open the voltage-gated calcium, and the entrance of the calcium will release a transmitter, a neurotransmitter, to stimulate the glossopharyngeal and cause action potential of this. يبقى how the carotid bodies or the peripheral chemoreceptors stimulated and fire the glossopharyngeal. The oxygen, when decreased, it will close the potassium channel, so make the cell depolarized and open the voltage-gated calcium. Entrance the calcium will release a neurotransmitter to cause a receptor potential will action potential. Then we will go to the central chemoreceptors. First, we must know that CO2, well, it is the principal chemical factor regulating ventilation, responsible for around 75% to 85% of the chemical regulation of respiration. CO2, not alone. Why CO2? Because the CO2 can diffuse, dissolve freely. It is lipid soluble, dissolve freely through lipid bilayer. Also can be eliminated easily by lung as a gas. Also can affect the hydrogen ion concentration for the body, because the CO2 when bind to H2O will yield H2CO3, which is very, very weak acid and dissociate into hydrogen and bicarbonate, so it can give us a hydrogen. So CO2 when increased, it will increase your hydrogen. Then going to the central chemoreceptors, these central chemoreceptors, a group of receptors that located in medulla oblongata. In medulla oblongata, it is where the respiratory center are present, but here it is beneath the ventral surface, besides but separate from. So it is in medulla oblongata, but separated from respiratory center. Near respiratory center, but separated. Has direct connection with this respiratory center. Very, very sensitive to CO2, not an oxygen or a hydrogen. Very, very sensitive to CO2. Again, the peripheral, very, very sensitive to the oxygen. The central, sensitively only to CO2. The peripheral, sensitive for the three, CO2, hydrogen, oxygen, but mainly to oxygen. But the central, only CO2. The central chemoreceptors, under normal condition, it drive 75% or 85% of respiratory drive due to stimulation of the central respiratory. It can drive a respiration about 80% when a respiratory regulation, and can be done by CO2. Central chemoreceptors are stimulated by CO2 through indirect way, or what we call it, through hydrogen ion dependent way. How we could tell this? Again, this is the capillary blood, and this is what we call it, a blood-brain barrier. This blood-brain barrier will separate a CSF, a cerebrospinal fluid, from LA, a capillary blood, and this cerebrospinal fluid will be around the higher center with medulla. We have here the medulla oblongata. The medulla contain central chemoreceptors or respiratory center. We hear the blood suffer from increasing of CO2. So CO2 can pass the blood-brain barrier, and when pass the blood-brain barrier, it binds to the water to form H2CO3 and dissociate into hydrogen and bicarbonate. So the hydrogen will pass from CSF to chemoreceptors, and the chemoreceptors in the CSF contain carbonic anhydrase. The carbonic anhydrase here forms this carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Carbonic anhydrase enzyme, this helps formation of carbonic acid with dissociation. CSF lack a buffer system. So any change of hydrogen, any change of hydrogen can affect the central chemoreceptors and affect the respiration. Again, the hydrogen in blood can pass? No. The oxygen in blood can pass here? No. It's CO2 only, that chemical which passes the blood-brain barrier, And when passed blood-brain barrier by carbonic anhydrase in CSF can form H2CO3 and the hydrogen. When a hydrogen is formed, it will pass to the peripheral chemoreceptors because absence of buffers. So these chemical, those chemoreceptors could be stimulated here by hydrogen. يبقى CO2 act through increasing hydrogen. So a response to CO2, when CO2 increased في arterial blood, it will stimulate the central and stimulate the peripheral. The central mainly around 75%, with peripheral chemoreceptors by 25, around 25%. By change again, it will stimulate the chemoreceptor by change the pH of the hydrogen ion في CSF. If I change the hydrogen في arterial blood, not affect the central, but it change the hydrogen فين في CSF. It will stimulate the medullary center to increase the respiration. We exhale more CO2. What about in oxygen? When the oxygen or PO2 decreased, so this decreased PO2 in inspired air or in blood will stimulate the peripheral chemoreceptors, not the center. The peripheral will go to the medullary respiratory center to increase the ventilation and make the PO2 better. What about the hydrogen level? When the hydrogen increases in arterial blood, it will stimulate also the peripheral, the central. When the hydrogen increases in CSF due to CO2 only in CSF, the peripheral chemoreceptors go to the medullary respiratory to increase the ventilation and decrease the CO2 VLA with hydrogen. So this is the summary. This is summary. We have respiratory centers in bones or medulla. It will be affected by higher center, higher brain, or centers coming from the limbic system or hypothalamus. Or we have respiratory, we have reflexes or nervous reflexes coming from the lung or the upper airway or lung or lower airway, either from the irritant receptors or the stretch receptors or G receptors. Also, we have reflexes coming from the skeletal muscle with pain. We have chemical with cardiovascular. We have chemoreceptor affection, either peripheral or central chemoreceptors. The peripheral coming from a decrease in oxygen or increase in CO2 with hydrogen. The central coming from increasing CO2. So at a quiz, or to refresh this knowledge, which of the following limits the duration of inspiration or increase the respiratory rates? Amnestic center? No, it is inspiratory only, so it has no limiting effect. A dorsal respiratory group? Also inspiratory, so has no limit. A pneumotaxic? Yes. It will increase the respiratory rate with limited duration of inspiration. What about the ventral? Ventral only forced during the forced either inspiration or expiration. About the hearing blower reflexes, it is originated from chemoreceptor, or baroreceptor, or mechanoreceptor, or carotid aortic bodies. Mechanoreceptors, the stretch receptors in lung.